of WGN News Now, coming to you live from our WGN News Now set to bring you a historic moment at Wrigley Field for one of the greatest players in the history of the Chicago Cubs. That is the statue unveiling for Fergie Jenkins, who will have that happen this afternoon at Wrigley. And we're actually here right now as it's about to happen. As you can see, a number of fans out there tuning in for this ceremony at Wrigley Field. So many people excited to see this moment. As many know, the Cubs have four statues that have been unveiled for players. He'll actually be the fourth: Billy Williams, Ron Santo, and of course, Ernie Banks in 2008, also having a statue in his honor outside of Wrigley Field. Now, you might also know that this is the first time that the Cubs are unveiling player statues in Gallagher Way. That's because the Cubs have decided to move some of those statues, not all of them that they have put up, into Gallagher Way. That's also due to the construction of a new sports book that right now is happening on Addison Street, so they had to move the Williams and the Santo one. And Ernie Banks' statue also moves in there. That's the new statues row, which you see in front of you. And that is where those statues are going to be for a while. Expect a few other Cubs player statues to be there. Let's just give you a look at the scene right now at Wrigley Field for the Fergie Jenkins statue unveiling. As you can see, the dignitaries for the Cubs starting to roll in. This ceremony is expected to have a few of his former teammates there. You can see a video of Fergie's great accomplishments as a member of the club being played on the video board above. And of course, when it comes to Jenkins, a wonderful career. Most of it was spent here in Chicago. He did have some time with the Texas Rangers. Fergie made his debut with the Cubs in 1966. He would pitch there through 1973, and then he would be there doing so with the Cubs during that time. And when that would take place, the Cubs were really good during most of his era. They were one of the best teams in the league. So it's going to be a great ceremony. It's going to be great to see how many people come out and support Fergie. You already see that there. Right now at the podium, you can see Billy Williams. You can see Pat Hughes, a longtime broadcaster for the Chicago Cubs. Cubs chairman Tom Ricketts is there as well. And you can see that the statue is still yet to be unveiled at Wrigley Field, sitting there with the blue tarp. And as you see, many people anticipating this. This ceremony is actually taking place before the Cubs face the Diamondbacks at Wrigley Field at 1:20 this afternoon. It looks like they're getting the festivities going as Pat Hughes steps up to the lectern. We're going to go ahead and join this ceremony live right now. And if you have a Facebook comment or a memory about Fergie, please feel free to send it. We will share as the live stream goes along. But now let's go to Pat Hughes at Wrigley Field.
8-3 at Dodger Stadium. The Cubs' winning pitcher that day was Fergie Jenkins. Naturally, he pitched a complete game. He struck out 8, and only one of the 3 runs was earned. The losing pitcher for the Dodgers was Fernando Valenzuela. For Fergie, it was his 150th win in a Cubs uniform and his 150th complete game. Hi, everybody. I'm Pat Hughes, Cubs broadcaster. Welcome and thank you for being here today. It's a beautiful sight here, Gallagher Way, outside of beautiful Wrigley Field, and I'm very proud to be here on this historic day. When I was hired by the Cubs back in 1995 to be an announcer, the Cubs pitching coach at that time was Fergie Jenkins. He was nice to me from day one, and that has never wavered. And that's just one of many reasons why I am very honored to be just a part of this special day for Fergie Jenkins. Let's cut right to the chase. Fergie Jenkins is the greatest pitcher in the long and legendary history of the Chicago Cubs. He possessed a rare combination of being both a power pitcher with great control. Beginning in 1967, Fergie was a 20-game winner for 6 consecutive years. 3 times he was an All-Star. In 1971, he reached the pinnacle by being named the National League Cy Young Award winner. Let's delve momentarily into Fergie's 1971 season. He led National League pitchers in the following categories: 39 games started, an amazing 30 complete games, 24 wins, and an astounding 325 innings pitched. And just for good measure, Fergie was a great hitter, if you're old enough to remember. As a hitter that year, Fergie had 6 home runs, including 2 in one game against Montreal, and he drove in 20. Who needs a DH when you've got a pitcher that can hit like that? In 1991, Fergie was inducted into the National Baseball Hall of Fame in Cooperstown, New York. Today, Fergie is going to be immortalized next to a few of his famous teammates, namely Ernie Banks, Ron Santo, and Billy Williams. Billy, by the way, is going to speak in a few moments, but I really do wish that both Ernie and Ronnie could be here today. They would have been absolutely thrilled to see this happen for their friend and teammate, Fergie. In our 15 years together broadcasting on Cubs radio, I heard Ron Santo say this many times. On the days when Fergie was pitching, we knew all we had to do was score about 3 runs, and then Fergie's pitching would take care of the rest, and the Cubs would win the ball game. And now let's keep the program moving. Thank you again for being here. I would like to introduce right now the chairman of the Chicago Cubs, Tom Ricketts.
Welcome, everybody. And this is a very, very special day for our entire organization, and we thank you for being here. I want to particularly thank Fergie's family and friends and everyone from Chatham, Ontario for showing up. We also have a really unique thing in our crowd today that just kind of really blows me away. You know, there's been tens of millions of kids who grew up dreaming that they wanted Major League Baseball players. Almost 20,000 of those kids became Major League Baseball players at some point. 268 of those Major League Baseball players made it to the Hall of Fame. 70 of them are still with us. And 5 are here right now. Thanks, guys. So I'd like to start by giving some numbers. In baseball, the numbers tell the story sometimes. And I'll start with these numbers. 165 innings, 135 strikeouts, and 12 wins. Today, a lot of pitchers would call that a good season. And in fact, that is basically the numbers that last year's National League Cy Young Award winner had. But 165 innings, 135 strikeout, and 12 wins was not a good season for Fergie Jenkins. He didn't call that a season at all. He called that the All-Star break. In fact, in 1971, as Pat referenced his incredible year, he had 263 strikeouts and only 37 walks. Think about that. And one of the most remarkable pitching performances in all of baseball history, of course, Fergie won the Cy Young. And as Pat referenced, he also hit 6 homers and only 115 at-bats. Pretty incredible. But you know, Fergie was an Iron Man, but he did more than just endure, he prevailed. He prevailed for 284 career wins, 3,192 career strikeouts, the 12th most in Major League Baseball history. And in 1971, as Pat referenced, he threw 30 complete games. And in fact, throughout his incredible career, he threw 267 complete games. And in fact, Fergie has completed more games, substantially more games, than all of today's modern pitchers in the league combined at the moment. It's incredible. You know, when Fergie was asked about this recently, he told his 52,000 Twitter followers that he completed games because his mother, Dolores, taught him to always finish what he started. Now, it is also worth noting that Fergie was more than a great pitcher, he was also a great athlete. Not only could he hit, but his athleticism went well beyond baseball. Being a Canadian, you might not be surprised that Fergie was an excellent hockey player as a young man. And of course, most people know that Fergie played for the Cubs, and he was a Ranger, and he was a Philly, and he was a Red Sox. But I don't think everybody knows he was also a Globetrotter. And a few years ago, I was at an event. I was fortunate enough to meet the legendary late great Meadowlark Lemon. And Meadowlark told me that if Fergie wanted to go into the NBA, he would have been a perennial all-star. So aside from being a great pitcher and a great athlete, we also know that Fergie Jenkins was always a great teammate. Some of my best personal memories have been sitting around listening to Fergie and his former teammates talk about the days they spent together in their Cubs uniforms. In retirement, he has been a great teammate to so many others. Not only has Fergie worked closely with Chicago Cubs charities, but he has also supported over 400 other charities through the Fergie Jenkins Foundation and his work with the Black History Museum. By speaking out against racial injustice when he sees it, Fergie is a great teammate to our whole society. So, indeed, many baseball fans will know Fergie for pitching the complete game, but to all of his friends, he'll be known for being the complete person. So today, we immortalize this complete person here in bronze next to his teammates, Ronnie, Ernie, Billy. And we do that so that Cub fans today and for generations to come can be reminded of his greatness. And perhaps, in some small way, to inspire us all to listen to Dolores and always finish what we start.
What's up? Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Darren Caniff, mayor of Chatham-Kent, Fergie Jenkins' hometown. It's an absolute honor to be here today to represent Chatham-Kent. I would have never in my wildest dreams thought I'd be speaking in one of the greatest cities in the world, helping to honor the greatest Canadian baseball player of all time. Fergie's baseball stats are well known, but they don't tell the whole story. He's an outstanding person, whose kindness and generosity are second to none. Whenever he's in Chatham-Kent, talking to groups there, he's reaching out, helping them. Fergie has always been there whenever he can. For years after he reached the majors, he would send a package back to Chatham to Dean DeJura, the scout who signed him in his first contract. Inside that package were a collection of spikes for major leaguers that Gene would distribute to players on local travel teams. Word got back to him once that there was one fellow with small feet who never got any spikes. Fergie went to Freddie Paddock, the 5 foot shortstop, 5 foot five shortstop of the Kansas City Royals, and had a pair of Freddie's spikes sent back. That's the kind of guy he is. Thanks to Tom and the Chicago Cubs for being such an amazing organization. It's been a 56-year journey from the moment you traded for Fergie to today in the dedication of this statue. It's clear you are a class act. Congratulations, Fergie, on this well-deserved honor. You have made your hometown a better place and have been an inspiration to so many people. Fergie, we are so proud of you in Chatham-Kent. You are awesome. It's now my pleasure to invite Hall of Famer Billy Williams up to say a few words.
Much, Mayor. Thank you and welcome to Gallagher Way at Wrigley Field. It's a pleasure for me to be here for the unveiling of the statue of Fergie Jenkins. This is a great honor. of all the other awards he received, he is most proud of the 6-time 20-game winner and, of course, the 3,000 strikeout. I remember that well, and, of course, it was in San Diego, California. We had a great time that night after the game. We enjoyed it. Talk about it. When I left home, Whistle, Alabama, going to play professional baseball in 1956, one of my teammates, a name was called a few minutes ago, Gene DeZura. And I think this is a guy name that was familiar in Chatham, Ontario, because he worked with a lot of young people. And of course, Fergie was a good athlete, and he liked hockey and basketball. But Gene DeZura asked Fergie to try baseball. And when Fergie tried baseball, there was something about him playing the game of baseball, and he was signed by the Philadelphia Phillies. Gene was a great guy. I understand he just passed away, but as I say, we were teammates in 1956. I didn't know he was from Chatham. I know he was from Chatham, but I didn't think this would wind up like it was. But I talked to him right after he had got Fergie to sign with the Philadelphia Phillies. When Fergie was traded to Chicago Cubs, Fergie was a relief pitcher. And I think it was maybe July that when Fergie came with the Chicago Cubs. He was a relief pitcher at the time, and he got in a few games, and our manager, Leo, looked over there and saw him throw the ball, and he liked what Fergie did on the mound. In 1966, at the end of the season, Leo DeRocher, who had been in baseball for many, many years, he said, next year I'm gonna make you a starter. And he did. The rest is history. But Fergie didn't give up on his interest in hockey and basketball. And it was said that, when he wanted to burn off some energy, after he pitched a one-hitter, two-hitter, when he wanted to burn off some energy, he would go and skate with the Blackhawks. He was a great skater. He never did give up on that. And, of course, it was mentioned that in the wintertime, when he wanted something to do, he played basketball with the Harlem Globetrotters. Because those are the two things he loved to do. And he didn't put them aside. He wanted to do the three things because he was such a great athlete. From the time Fergie joined the club, we became friends. I didn't know him at first. He came from Philadelphia. And of course, he was only with the Cubs for a few months. As we have conversation more and more, we found our interest was the same. Our interest was fishing and hunting. And we did a lot of that, just to take away from the game of baseball. And in addition, we had 6 girls between us. And that made the family grow closer and closer together. To my teammate and friend, from the bottom of my heart, dude, from the bottom of my heart, congratulations.
And now the moment of truth has arrived. To help us unveil the statue, I would like to invite Fergie and his family to come on up and help us see this statue for the very first time. Come on up. Thank you.
one.
In Chatham, Ontario, Canada, a boy was born. Ferguson Arthur Jenkins by name. A son, an athlete, a gifted person he became. And whereas Chicago Cubs saw the potential, they knew he'd develop into something very, very special. And whereas Fergie went on, an excellent professional pitcher to be, he matured into the character of a fine man, as you're about to see. A citizen, team player, coach, philanthropist, with a magnanimous personality, a fine ambassador for this game, country, and this club community. And whereas inducted into the Baseball Hall of Fame in 1991, the Order of Canada in 2007, Canada Post Stamp in 2011, and now here we are, as family, teammates, friends, and acquaintances, beaming with pride to witness a well-deserved honor by the Cubs to Fergie so graciously implied. Therefore, be happy, as the Cub organization has seen fit to erect this action sculpture for all to remember and for all ages to see. May Fergie be a continuing example to follow and imitate throughout all future baseball history. We are proud of what he has done for this Cub community and our Chatham-Kent municipality. God bless Fergie Jenkins. God save the Queen. God bless the Constitution of the United States. And now, ladies and gentlemen, I deem it a great honor and a privilege to present to you Ferguson Arthur Jenkins, known to all, Fergie!
Guys, thanks everybody in Chicago, great fans, appreciate that, thank you. When I was a little kid growing up in Chatham, Ontario, throwing rocks at passenger trains, never did I imagine being a 20-game winner, all right? Being an all-star, winning a Cy Young, and being a member of the 3,000 strikeout club, or even being in the Hall of Fame. But now this statue is sitting beside my fellow teammates, Ernie, Billy, and Ronnie. Believe me, I'm humble. I stand here, a proud man, also humble. First, I'd like to thank the Cub organization, the Ricketts family, Tom, Laura, and Todd. You brought something to the North Side that generations of Cub owners couldn't do, a world's champion to the North Side. My gut tells me it won't be the last. As a player, I had three incentives. You play for the team, you play for your family, you play for the fans. I had the best team, the best family, and the best guys to play ball with. Believe me. Thank you, because I had an incredible family. Ferguson Jenkins Sr., my mother Dolores, Louise Jenkins, they were always supporting me in my career. And I want to thank my first wife, Kathy, and my children, Kelly, Dolores, Kimberly, Raymond, and Samantha. Incredible grandkids, too. Thank you. I wish the wind would stop. The wind's blowing out to right field. Watch out, boys. Jeez. Oh, really? I pitched many a day coming up Addison and turning onto the ballpark and going, oh, the wind's blowing out again today. I'm grateful because I had a great family. It was a great experience, especially because of today. You know, I think the statue will be long here after I'm gone, and it's a great tribute to myself and my family. You know, knowing and being a part of a professional family is not easy. They sacrifice a lot day in and day out so an individual like myself can live out my dream. And it's nice to know my grandkids will be able to see Grandpa Fergie for days and years here in Wrigley Field. As a player, I was given the opportunity to pitch for the best managers in history. Best managers in baseball history. And there's a few names. I can't recall all of them, but I'm going to give a shout out to a couple. My first manager, Leo DeRocher. All right. He was an extreme and unconventional individual. Okay. Come on, Wynn, relax. A few things are about Leo, and there's a few stories I'd like to share with you, especially one. The Cubs were having spring training in Palm Springs playing the Angels in 1968 in California. I'm sitting in the dugout in the second inning, and all of a sudden, all the players stopped looking down the right field line. The fans stopped. The game stopped. The umpire stopped the game. And who comes in but Frank Sinatra and his entourage? Leo DeRocher motions him to the dugout. The game stops. Frank comes down to the bench and coaches the Cubs for two innings. Believe me, that was incredible. You know, I had another great manager at the time, Billy Martin. And we were together in Texas together. And he was the individual that said to me, he said, I've heard you can't win anymore. And I said, Skip, you give me that ball every fourth day, I'll win you some ball games. So one of my best years I've had and it was in 1974. I was able to win 25 ball games and win the Comeback Player of the Year award. You know, every pitcher needs a good pitching coach, and I was very fortunate enough in the Philly organization to have Al Widmar and Cal McClish, especially Cal, taught me that slider in winter ball. Biggest things that a pitching coach can teach you, you have to plan the game, you execute, you know how to pitch to certain hitters to set them up, mound awareness, this contributed to my success. You play the game as a youngster, and you dream of being a professional ball player. And you see some of the greatest players play. And I was very fortunate enough to get scouted by the Phillies, Gene DeJura, and signed at the age of 18 out of Chatham, Ontario. His son, Chris, is here. Hi, Chris, wherever you're at. Then came the trade from the Phillies to the Cubs to one of the best cities in baseball, Chicago. My first roommate, Byron Brown, is here. Where you at, Brownie? All right. In 1966, we were roommates. We had a lot of fun. My other roommate was Ernie Banks, a special person, a special player. He taught me more than just what the game of baseball was all about. He taught me to respect the game and be a professional, and be a professional all the time. As a pitcher, I learned to win. Losing never entered my mind. I had teammates that definitely helped me in that situation. Ernie, Billy Williams, Randy Hundley, Rich Nye, Ron Santo, Glenn Beckard, Kenny Holzman, and Don Kessinger, and so many others. Without them, I wouldn't have been as successful as I was. Now, I want to thank the loyal Cub fans, especially the Bleacher Bums, for their love and support. Without you, it wouldn't have been possible. Truly the best fans in baseball. Lastly, I want to thank all my friends and fellow players, professionals, and friends, and fellow Chathamites that are here. All right. I know you traveled far and wide to be here. I'm glad you had a chance to celebrate this day with me. Thank you. When I was 14 years old, my dad took me to my first Major League ball game, and I seen Larry Doby hit two home runs in Tiger Stadium. I turned to my dad and I said, "Dad, that's what I want to be, a professional ball player." Little did I know it was going to work out so good. But you know, I thank my father for giving that opportunity, because he was an individual that played in the Negro League. He barnstormed in Canada, and he gave me that incentive to be a ball player, along with so many others. My dream came true, thanks to the Cub organization. Mr. Wrigley was my first owner, and believe me, he gave me that opportunity to really shine as a Chicago Cub. Once again, I want to thank the Ricketts family for this particular day and the statue, and my dreams have come true. Now let's have the Budweiser flowing, and don't forget to have one in the honor of Ron Santo, Harry Carey, and Mr. Cub Ernie Banks, and Billy and I will celebrate it together for sure. Thank you, thank you. Thanks everybody.
All right, this is Larry Hawley here in the WGN News Now newsroom. You have just watched the official unveiling of the Fergie Jenkins statue at Gallagher Way on Statue Row. You can see right now taking a few pictures for the Cubs Television Network, for some of the photographers, actually many of the photographers who are in the audience, along with the many fans who have gathered at Gallagher Way to watch this tribute to a legendary Chicago Cubs pitcher, a Hall of Famer, one of the players who was the face of the franchise during their very popular era in the late 1960s and then the early 1970s, when the club did not win a championship but were arguably one of the stars of all of Chicago sports. They were certainly embraced by the fan base. Many still talk about how important that team was, and Fergie was a big part of that. Obviously, over the last couple of minutes, you heard a number of speeches. Tom Ricketts discussing some of the great feats that Ferguson Jenkins had during his career. You might remember that he was in an era where a lot of pitchers completed games, so he had a number of contests in which he started games and would finish games. That's why Fergie was able to have six consecutive 20-win seasons for the Cubs. He three times made the All-Star game, and then, of course, in 1971, he won the Cy Young Award. That would be the only one in his career. And so certainly deserving for Fergie to have this moment at Wrigley Field. He becomes the fourth player in Cubs history to have a statue outside of Wrigley. He's the fifth overall. Do not forget that broadcaster Harry Carey had a statue made in his honor. That remains at Wrigley Field, but that will not be part of Statue Row. That's actually going to remain behind the bleachers on the corner of Waveland and Sheffield. It will stay there. Meanwhile, the Ron Santo statue, the Billy Williams statue, and of course the Ernie Banks statue will all be finding their way to Statues Row. That is right now at Gallagher Way. That's something brand new for the Cubs, something that they unveiled just before the home opener. Of course, doing so before they decided to create a new statue. That is for Fergie Jenkins, the pitcher, the Hall of Fame pitcher, who had that honor given to him in 1991, now gets a statue, becoming the fourth Cub player to do so, joining his teammates Ernie Banks, Billy Williams, and Ron Santo. Now, just for a minute, we're welcoming your comments here on Facebook as well, if you have some memories to share of Fergie. Let's just talk a little bit about his career. We mentioned that he played for the Cubs from 1966 through 1973, and then he made his return in 1982 and 1983, and he's arguably the best Cubs pitcher in franchise history. He won 167 of his 184 games in Chicago with the Cubs. We mentioned before those 20 contests that he won for six consecutive seasons. That included that great stretch from the Cubs in the late 1960s and the early 1970s. They never made the playoffs, but they were a popular team, always in the hunt for a championship, just could never quite get it done. He was also named an All-Star three times, earning that nod in 1967, 1971, and 1972. 1971, arguably the best year of his career. Very easy to argue that since he won the National League Cy Young Award, 24-13 with a 2.77 ERA. He had 39 starts that year, 30 complete games, something that just does not happen at the current baseball with just how they run bullpens right now. You really don't see that. Fergie, as far as career stats, 284 victories compared to 226 defeats, 3.34 ERA. He played 10 years with the Cubs, 6 years with the Rangers. He had 2 years with the Phillies, whom he broke into the major leagues with. And then in between his stretches in Texas, he had two of them. He played for the Boston Red Sox in 1976 and in 1977. Jenkins, arguably, as I said before, the greatest pitcher in the history of Chicago Cubs baseball. You might have some that would argue that otherwise. Some might think that it's a little different. Some might have other people whom they might consider to be in that list. I would consider Fergie probably the greatest pitcher of all time in franchise history. But again, you have your own opinion. If you have a thought on Fergie, we got about a minute or two left on here, please share your memory on Facebook. We'll certainly be happy to put them up. Talking a little bit about Fergie, here's some footage of him at Wrigley Field in the early 1970s. Again, the one thing people loved about Fergie was the fact that he was able to finish games, and he was somebody who had six straight 21 seasons. He had a win, 24 victories with the Cubs in that 1971. And here's the ceremony from 1991 when Fergie was inducted into the Baseball Hall of Fame. Of course, a number of his former teammates on that team are there as well. Ernie Banks was there. Billy Williams was inducted. Ron Santo also inducted. Unfortunately, that came after his death when he passed away in December of 2010. Fergie, one of the greatest ever to put on a Cubs uniform, and he was also immortalized not only with a statue, but going back 13 years now, he had his number 31 retired by the Cubs. That number is also retired for Greg Maddux. He also had two eras with the Cubs. Maddux starting out with the franchise in the late 80s and then into the early 90s, winning the 1992 Cy Young Award before signing with Atlanta, where he was arguably the most dominant pitcher of the 1990s. So he shares that honor with Fergie, Greg in the Hall of Fame, and of course Fergie is too, happening in 1991. Checking over here to Facebook to see some of the late comments that we're getting on here. We'll try to pull at least a couple of them in here. Tam Zach, coming through with a comment. Way to go, Fergie. You deserve this. Seen a lot of those come through so far. Denny here with a congratulations to Fergie as well. We've been trying to put as many of these up here as we can during this segment. A lot of hearts as well. Deborah also saying a great day, wonderful day for the Cubs. As you might have heard Fergie say during his speech, it was a little windy. He recalled a number of times he would be driving up to the ballpark, maybe down Waveland Avenue, where you get a good view of the flags that would be flying above the scoreboard, blowing out as it does a lot of times at Wrigley Field. Certainly did today. The Cubs, of course, playing at 120 against the Diamondbacks, looking to get a win. They lost 3-1 last night to the Diamondbacks. And how about John? That's a beautiful thing. Thumbs up. We'll complete our Facebook comments on there. We appreciate everybody who tuned in on Facebook, on WGNTV.com, or for those who might have tuned in on our YouTube page. We really appreciate it. I'll run over there and see if we have any comments. Nothing really over there, so we're going to go ahead and wrap up this live stream for Fergie Jenkins having his statue dedicated at Wrigley Field this afternoon. We really appreciate you tuning in for this historic moment that took place at Gallagher Way. Now, if you want to watch the replay of this ceremony, you can go ahead and go to the webpage of WGN-TV. That's WGNTV.com. Click on the WGN News Now page. We will have that replay up momentarily. And, of course, if you want to see sports coverage of all teams in Chicago, please come to WGNTV.com and here to WGN News Now. But for right now, I am Larry Hawley, and I hope you have a wonderful day and a wonderful weekend.